In this video, we're going to do an example of a proof of a biconditional proposition. And in particular, we're going to do this one here. Let A, B, and P be natural numbers, such that P is a prime. Then P divides the product AB, if and only if P divides A or P divides B. So this is a biconditional statement because you see the if and only if here. And so you're really trying to, you're claiming two things. You're claiming, first of all, that if P divides AB, then P divides A or P divides B. And conversely, you're claiming that if P divides A or P divides B, then P divides AB. So you have to prove both of those. And the proofs of those will each appear in separate paragraphs. Now, before you do that, I'd like you to write out the original statement using symbols. Now, I think what we're going to do in order to help you do that is all of this information in the first sentence should be statements about quantifiers and universal sets. We really want the hypotheses and conclusions to be just this part and this part. We don't want the part about P being prime to be part of the hypothesis. So what we'll do is we'll introduce a new universal set, namely the set of all primes. And so let's define a set capital P to denote the set of all primes. And if you use that letter, then when you're quantifying the fact that P is a prime, you're going to put for all P in this set capital P. Okay, so now go ahead, put your video on pause, and write out this statement using symbols, and make use of this notation, capital P, for the set of all primes. Okay, so here's the statement written in symbols. For all primes, little p, and for all integers or natural numbers a and b, p divides the product ab if and only if either p divides a or p divides b. So now the next thing to consider is what is the format for writing up a proof of a biconditional proposition? Well, you might recall that this is a slide that I showed you in a previous video, where it basically gives you the general format for proving a biconditional statement. And so the idea is, in one paragraph you prove P implies Q, and in another paragraph you prove Q implies P. But you see, if you really write down all of this stuff here and here, that could really involve quite a bit of writing, because P and Q might themselves be rather complicated. And maybe it's really not necessary to present things in that way. So one device some people use, and you'll find this in a lot of books and research articles, is that instead of writing, we first prove that P implies Q is true, they'll just simply write something like this. They'll put P arrow Q, so they'll write this conditional out. They'll just write that, and then they'll start writing the proof of P implies Q. And then when it comes time to do the proof of Q implies P, they'll just simply write this, and then they just start writing their proof. Okay, and if you do that, you'll find that it's really easy to get a sense of what the writer is doing. It will be clear to you what's going on in the proof, and I think that my suggestion is for you to do things in that way. Okay, so now in order to come up with a proof of this, we need some kind of an idea. So let's have a look at it. There are two directions, and let's begin by looking at the backwards direction, the one that says that if P divides A or P divides B, then P divides AB. So that one, I claim, is really very simple, and you're going to be able to come up with that proof just using working definitions of divides. So I'm going to leave that one for you. Just look at, you know, you're going to start by assuming that P divides A or P divides B. So, you know, case one, case two. Case one would be that P divides A. and then you write down the working definition of that, and I think you won't have any trouble showing that, by definition, that P divides AB. So I'll leave that one for you. The more difficult direction is the one that says if P divides AB, then either P divides A or P divides B. So in that direction, I'm asking you to make use of the fundamental theorem of arithmetic that we looked at in an earlier video. So how are we going to make use of the fundamental theorem of arithmetic? We start with a prime that divides a product. Now, one thing that comes out of the fundamental theorem of arithmetic is that if P divides a number, then P must appear in the prime factorization of that number. So if P divides AB, then P must appear on the prime factorization of AB. But how do you get the prime factorization of AB? How do you write AB as a product of primes? Well, if you just simply take the prime factorization of A and the prime factorization of B and you multiply them together, you're going to get the prime factorization of AB. So again, it follows from fundamental theorem of arithmetic that the prime factorization of AB is the product of the prime factorizations of A and the prime factorization of B. So if P divides AB, and therefore P must appear in the prime factorization of AB, well then it must appear either in the prime factorization of A, in which case P would have divided A, or P appears in the prime factorization of B, in which case P divides B. And so that's the idea of the proof of how you deduce that, given that P divides AB, that P divides A or P divides B. So now, I think it's worthwhile writing down those two facts that we can get from the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. So I've written them down over here. So these are the two things that we really need. So what do they say? They say that these are things that one gets from the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. It says prime P divides a natural number if and only if that prime P appears in the prime factorization of that natural number. And the second fact is that the prime factorization of a product, AB, is obtained by multiplying the prime factorizations of A and of B. So my suggestion to you is that when you begin writing up the forward direction of the proof of the proposition, you should begin by stating these things and just say that the following two things are consequences of the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. Okay, so now I want you to go ahead and write the proof of this thing. And as you're doing the proof, make sure you look at the statement written in symbols, because that's going to help you organize your proof. Now, it may be a little bit involved. It may take you a little bit of time to come up with the proof. But stick with it. Try to write it up in detail. And then when you come back, you can compare your solution to mine. Okay, so here's my proof. Let's go over it together. So you notice I'm using this device of indicating this for the forward direction and indicating this symbol for the proof of the backwards direction. And I decided that those two properties that I talked about before are needed only in the proof of the forward direction, and so I write those in the paragraph of the proof of the forward direction. I don't need them for the other direction. If I needed them for both directions, then I would have started by making these comments, and then I would have put this forward arrow. But I'm only going to use it in this direction, and so I write it in the body of that proof. So I start by making these introductory comments. We shall make use of the following two consequences of the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. One, a prime divides a natural number if and only if that prime appears in the prime factorization of that natural number. And two, the prime factorization of any product, AB, of natural numbers is obtained by multiplying the prime factorizations of A and of B. Okay, so with those preliminaries out of the way, I'm going to start the proof of this implies this. So I'm going to give a direct proof. So let's look at the symbols. The symbols are going to tell us what the first two sentences should be. We should begin by looking here and say, let P be a prime, and let A and B be natural numbers. So that's what I did. Now, suppose the hypothesis is true. Suppose that P divides AB. Okay, now I'm trying to get to this, so I'm not going to say anything about that until I've proved it. So you won't find anything about my saying P divides A or P divides B until the very end of that paragraph where I've actually proved it. So all I'm allowed to use is the fact that P divides AB, and I've decided not to do things from just using basic working definitions. I'm going to use this powerful theorem, the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. So I say, by fact 1 above, P must appear in the prime factorization of AB, and by 2, this thing here, either P must appear in the prime factorization of A, in which case P divides A, or P appears in the prime factorization of B, in which case P divides B. So we have thus proven that P divides A or B, thus completing the proof of the forward half of the proposition. So I'm essentially finished with the forward half, and we're done with it. And now we're going to begin on the reverse half. The reverse half means this now becomes my hypothesis, this now becomes my conclusion. And of course, this still stands. This is still the statement about the names of the variables, their universal sets, and their quantifiers. Okay, so your I should go here. You're starting over again. So how do you read a direct proof if this is how it begins? It's let P be prime and let A and B be natural numbers. And now this time, we're going to assume the hypothesis, which is this. So suppose that either P divides A or P divides B. That's what I wrote here. And now I'm trying to deduce that P divides AB. So I'm not going to say anything about that until the very end of the proof when I've actually proved it. Okay, so but this time I think we can just do things from working definitions. We've got two cases, right? We're assuming that P divides A or P divides B. So the first case would be, say, P divides A. So I say, suppose that P, consider first the case that P divides A. And what I do is I just simply write down the definition of that. Then by definition, there exists an integer C such that A is equal to P times C. Now I multiply both sides of that by B to get thus AB is equal to PCB. And now you can see, you know, this CB is an integer. So I've written AB as P times an integer. And therefore, and so by definition, I've proven that P divides AB. So it follows by definition, P divides AB, proving the desired result in this case, namely the case that P divides A. Now, in principle, I should also consider the possibility, the case that P divides B. But the proof is so similar to the proof in case P divides A that I don't really want to trouble the reader to go through it. So I just simply say the proof in case P instead divides B is similar. I think that's good enough. This completes the proof of the backwards half of the proposition. And so we're done. That's the end of the proof. Just a couple of final comments. A lot of students have good mathematical ideas. They understand mathematically what needs to be done, but not necessarily how to write it up so that they're saying things accurately, correctly, and grammatically correctly as well. So make sure you pay special attention to your presentation, not just the mathematics that's involved. I can assure you that when I wrote up this final version of the proof, it took me several tries in order to get it the way it appears here. So don't think that we can just at some point just simply do it and it becomes easy. We're always editing what we write, making sure that it reads just the way it ought to.